And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce Zach Halmstad to you. Zach graduated from the University of Wisconsin-Eau Claire in 2004. He has a major in music and a minor in computer science. And in 2013, he received the Outstanding Recent Alumnus Award. During his time at UWEC, he worked at our IT department, and this experience helped lay the groundwork for him to start his company, Jamf Software. The company currently has 8 offices, over 575 employees, and over 8,500 customers worldwide. And Zach actually has just come back from a business trip to Europe and is a little jet lagged. In 2012, Zach started Pablo Properties. Pablo has built a permanent home for Jamf Software, renovated the Lismore Hotel, and is a partner in renovating the Oxbow Hotel, all in downtown Eau Claire. And he's going to be talking about how his liberal arts education enabled his and his colleagues' entrepreneurship in Eau Claire.
So I feel like Judge Stark and I should have maybe compared notes because I'm going to be repeating a few things, but I think that's actually just fine. I find sometimes it's easier to speak in front of groups where you don't know anyone, and I see a lot of faces that I know here today. I have some very good friends here. I have some of my favorite teachers actually here in the crowd today. The chancellor's here, and of course, as usual, my parents are here supporting me as well, so that always makes things a little bit harder for me. So I grew up in Eau Claire. I started UW-Eau Claire at university here in 1996 as a music education major. As you can see by that, I did not take the four-year route. Through that time, I actually was a number of different majors. I started as music ed. I tried out accounting, which was definitely not for me. I had computer science as a major for one semester, which is also not for me. Went back to music education for a while and then ended up finally as I had a last-ditch effort to try and finally graduate, going to a liberal arts and music degree. So that was my very long and very enjoyable journey through UW-Eau Claire. I'm going to give a little bit of background on my two companies here before we go into kind of how my liberal arts background has prepared me as well as my coworkers to be successful. This all started for me in 1997 when the Blimpies that I worked at closed down. And I had to find a new job. I went all over Eau Claire submitting my resume, which basically had my name on it, to every tech company in Eau Claire, everyone that did computer repair, every web design company, because I thought I want to be involved in this. I know a little bit about it. I'd like to know more. And absolutely nothing. No one would even call me back. Through that time, kind of by accident, I found a job posting at what is now LTS, which was CNS back then, and I magically got a job as a student employee inside CNS, all because I could answer one question, which was, how do you boot a Mac off a CD? That was the hardest technical question then. Apparently, I was the only one on campus that knew it, because I got the job. So I worked there as a student for a couple years. I learned an incredible amount, met a lot of faculty members, and really started to understand the purpose of the university. And it was I had a great boss named Matt who taught me that our job as IT people was to support these professors who know more than we possibly could imagine about these topics that are here to help all these students learn. When Matt took another job inside LTS, I actually applied for his job and got that in 2000. So through that time, I was actually working full-time in our IT department here, still going to school, and was learning a lot about IT, how it worked, and I saw all my colleagues on the Windows side that had all these great tools, and here I was on the Mac side, and I had a technology that we refer to in the industry as sneakernet, meaning you walk everywhere. And I thought, hey, you know what? This can be done. No one's doing it, so I'm gonna try and do this. So in 2002, we founded Jamf. So I was doing Jamf basically from 6 o'clock until 2 in the morning. I would wake up and come to work at CNS, and then I would go to school in between breaks when I had a chance to. When I finally graduated in 2004, I actually put in my notice at the university for my job as well, and I went full-time into Jamf. had about 2.5 years where I didn't get a paycheck. Every penny that I had went into buying a plane ticket to go see another customer. One of the great things about living in Eau Claire is that my mortgage was basically a car payment, so I could kind of get by pretty easily. And that went on for, like I said, about 2.5 years. And in 2007, we finally started hiring people, and we really haven't stopped since. As you heard a few minutes ago, we have 8 offices around the world, a little over 575 full-time employees, and we have over 100 UWEC graduates inside our organization. Through that time, in about 2012, we decided that we really want to make sure that Jamf has a permanent foundation in Eau Claire. We were outgrowing our office space, and we wanted to make a statement that we are always going to be here. So we decided to build a building in downtown Eau Claire. Real estate is not a good investment for a software company that's growing as rapidly as we were. So we were actually looking at having someone else build the building for us. And we found out that what we wanted was a little bit more than what we wanted to pay for. I decided that I would actually start another company that was a real estate company and basically rent it back to Jamf for cost. So that's how Pablo was born, is I found a way that we could give Jamf a nicer office than what they wanted to pay for. About 2.5 months after we actually moved into our office is when we bought the Lismore, which was formerly the Ramada. We spent 2.5 years renovating that. Inside that, we have a restaurant, a coffee shop, and a bar. And we're also almost done as a partner inside the Oxbow Hotel with the Oxbow and the Lakely, hopefully opening up early next month. And all together in there, we have over 150 full-time employees between all of those businesses. So before I go into a little bit more about my story and how my liberal arts education affected me and how it's affected all of my coworkers, I'm going to basically copy a slide from you. That's all right, and go into a couple definitions. First, the definition, this is from not Webster's Dictionary, but the Apple Dictionary on my laptop. Entrepreneur is defined as a person who organizes and operates a business or businesses taking on greater than normal financial risks in order to do so. Liberal arts education, this is a little bit different than yours, and I'm not gonna read it because I'll stumble over it. These two don't really sit with me. They're not bad, I just don't get them. So I'm gonna show you my definitions that are a little bit simpler, and I think I can relate to the stories I'm hopefully gonna tell. Entrepreneur is simply a person who does something that's not being done. It might be something that's never been done before. It might be something that someone else is doing and they have an idea on how to do it better. It might be someone who travels and comes back and says, I saw this really cool thing and I wanna do it here. It's not being done here yet. So that's really what I view an entrepreneur as. And for an entrepreneur, I view the liberal arts education as an education that teaches a person how to learn. So when you look at what an entrepreneur has to do to try and do something that's not being done, they have to learn. And that education really prepares them on a daily basis to go out and learn the things that they have to do this new thing. And as I look at how the liberal arts education has impacted the employees that we have, I'm going to expand on that definition just a little bit and say it's an education that teaches a person how to learn and adapt in a rapidly changing world and workforce. Very, very similar to the definition that you gave. So with that, I'm going to go into a little bit of story on how this has affected me personally. As an entrepreneur, you get to wake up every day and do something different, something that you've never done before, and you have to go out and learn it. And you frequently run into this kind of chicken and the egg situation where, hey, it'd be really great if we could hire someone to do this that's a professional in it, but we don't have any money. And to get money, we have to get this done so that people will give us money, and it's this whole really bad circle to be in. And really, your only choice is either go raise a whole bunch of capital from someone else or learn how to do it yourself. But you can't just be an amateur at it. You actually have to present yourself to the world as someone who's done this before. So when I look at this, I look at being a jack of all trades and a master of whatever is important today. In my time at Jamf over the last 14 and a half years, I've pretended to be an expert in a lot of things. I hope none of that's super illegal. I was not, no. So if you look at my background in education as a computer science minor, didn't even come close to preparing me necessarily for what I had to do as a software developer. While we were not in the spot to hire enough people to build all of the software that we were trying to sell, I ended up having to learn all of these new things about software architecture. I had to write software in 7 different languages within the first couple years. All of these things that I had never done before. I had to kind of be a little bit of an expert in accounting and finance. I had to actually be a graphic designer very frequently through Jamf's history. And then there's a couple that I'm going to go a little bit deeper into. The first one was technical writing. So when we launched version 1 of our software in 2002, we released this little tiny manual. It's probably about 40 pages long. And after that, we said, all right, this is one of those things that we're going to pay someone else to do. And we went to the outside world for about 3.5 years and paid outside professionals to build us documentation. Every single one of those failed. Every time we tried to get someone else to come and do this, we could not get something that we could actually ship to our customers. So after 3.5 years of basically selling software, very highly technical software with zero documentation, we got the feedback that we actually have to sit down and do this. So that fell on my shoulders. I went out and I bought a bunch of books on technical writing. I spent about 2 weeks reading those books and then got sick of it and then went to a coffee shop for 3 weeks and wrote about 420 pages. And for the next 3 years, it was my job to maintain those 400 to 450 pages of documentation. Every time we got new software ready, I spent 2 weeks going through every page of that, updating all of it. It took us about 3 more years to actually get to the spot where we could hire someone to do that internally. And today we have a team of about 10 people that manage that documentation along with others. The second one that was probably one of my favorite things I got to learn inside Jamf was how to be an educator. We started probably in about 2009 offering certifications on our software. Certifications in the IT industry are frequently laughed at, they're scoffed at as kind of being a joke. They've gotten better over time, but especially back then, the one certification I had was probably the biggest waste of time I've ever gone through. And we said, if we're gonna do this and we're gonna certify people, we're gonna make sure it's worth their time. So again, I went out and bought 3 books. I was very lucky that the third one was a book called Building Expertise by Ruth Clark, something I highly recommend to any educator and especially chairs of departments that wanna evaluate how their teachers are doing. I read that book and I learned so much about how people learn in different styles of teaching. And I was able to look back at my career, all of my 8 years at UW-Eau Claire, and look at all the different classes I had and who taught in what style. And all of a sudden, I had this huge revelation of how complicated it was for me to go through all these different classes. And I found the one style of teaching that I had one teacher that did that in my career at UW-Eau Claire. And it was very interesting that the biggest impact on us doing certification of our IT software was from a music theory teacher. It was one of the most complicated subjects that I ever studied. And the teacher that I had was absolutely amazing. And when we looked at how we were structuring this class, this book kind of laid out how we could do it, and we tried to mimic him as a teacher. So that's a little bit of how this has kind of been part of my life as being an everyday learner. And I've had to go through and, again, pretend to be an expert in a lot of different fields. Next, I'd like to talk a little bit about the diversity of liberal arts inside Jamf. If you look at a software company that builds software for IT departments, there's a number of things that you'd expect to find inside our organization. We have computer science majors. We have information systems people that help us with the IT side. We're a worldwide company, so you'd expect to find some things like international business, business administration, accounting, all those functions that we need. And we have a sales and marketing team, so all these things that help us go out and meet people, have our ad campaigns, all that sort of stuff. So these are majors that you would really look at our organization and expect to see. Then we've got all kinds of ones that you wouldn't expect to see in a software company. I was a music major. My primary partner at Jamf was a geography major. Rachel, who is the director of our account management team, who actually runs almost half of our revenue inside Jamf, was also a geography major. Julia, who is my partner in Pablo Properties, for a long time was our events planner inside Jamf, did our first couple office buildouts inside Jamf, has now managed over $35 million worth of construction projects in Eau Claire as a biology major. Our very first employee that we had was an economics major. He graduated from UW Eau Claire in December. He turned down a job offer with a multinational bank. His parents weren't super happy about that. I actually got called out at his wedding by the priest because they were so mad about it. But so Nick came in and was kind of employee number one for us on January 1st of 2007. And has had a very successful career with us and now is actually managing our entire research organization. This one was my favorite story of all of these. When we first moved to Eau Claire and started building an office, we had this tiny little 2,000 square foot office in downtown Eau Claire. When we first moved in, there were four of us. So it was just it was a fishbowl. Like you'd look in the window and there were four of us sitting on one couch and that was the entire office. And people asked us, why are you putting an office in Eau Claire? You've already got all four people that you can find in Eau Claire. There's no one else that can help you. These are obviously people from outside of Eau Claire. And you know, we said that's not true, but we didn't have any facts to back it up. And so about a year and a half into having an office in Eau Claire, we probably had about a little less than 10 people in Eau Claire, and Sam came to us. Sam runs our account management and support functions. At the time, his department was probably two or three people, and now it's probably a few hundred. He came to us with something that he called the Levy experiment. And Levy was one of our friends who was a sociology major. He had graduated a few years earlier. He was working as a bartender. And he was, not joking at all, the least technical person I've ever met in my life. Knew absolutely nothing. I mean, if you gave him an iPhone, his kid could have used it, but he couldn't have. So Sam had this theory that he could take Levy, who he knew was a hard worker, who was a really good human being, who had a great liberal arts education, and Sam said, I can actually make him so technical that he can support our customers. And that was his primary job when he came in, was to provide technical support to our customers. We scoffed a little bit at his plan and said, Sam, you're going to spend your only budget on someone who can't come in the door and help you right now. And he said, yeah, I am. So we backed him up on it. And he came in and within 3 or 4 months was actually on the phone helping customers. The experiment worked so well that we've actually gone forward and hired tons and tons of people in Eau Claire and Minneapolis based on this. And if you look at what that actually gives you over the last 7 or 8 years, this is actually the breakdown of majors that you find inside Jamf Software. I don't have all of them inside our organization, but there were 40 that I was able to identify over the last few weeks just inside our organization. If you look at some of these in here, I don't know why we would ever need an actuarial science major or a kinesiology. Actually, we could really use a kinesiology major, but horticulture science, all these things that you wouldn't expect to find in an organization like ours. But they're really impactful. This is part of our diversity. We have people with different educational backgrounds that come in and help us think differently, help us react to the world around us differently. One of Jamf's two core values is relentless self-improvement. The industry that we're in moves so fast, and we have to keep up with every single piece of that environment. If we don't, we get just slayed by our customers. So we have this organization of now 575 people that is very nimble, that shows up to work every day, ready and willing to learn new things. And if we didn't have that ability to learn and adapt, we would fail as an organization. So there's one last story I want to tell, and this one's actually about Steve Jobs. A lot of people point to the fact that Steve Jobs never graduated from college. People point at that fact and say, you know, no one needs to go to college, Steve Jobs didn't, and look how successful he was. Well, he attended Reed University for one semester. I should say he paid to go to Reed University for one semester. And during that semester, he took a calligraphy class. They have a whole calligraphy building there, and he kind of randomly took this calligraphy class. He dropped out after one semester, but for the next 18 months, he stayed in Portland and continued to audit calligraphy classes. It's basically all he did was look at calligraphy when he was 19 years old. And there's a quote that I have from him, not the one that you see in front of you here, but he talks about when we were designing the first Macintosh computer, it came back to me. He was talking about calligraphy. And we designed all of it into the Mac. It was the first computer with beautiful typography. If I had never dropped in on that single course in college, the Mac would have never had multiple typefaces or proportionally spaced fonts. And since Windows copied Mac, it's likely that no computer would have them. So if Reed didn't have this calligraphy program, the world would not have Apple as we know it today. And my presentation today might have looked much more like this than like this. All of this because of a random class that Steve Jobs walked into as part of his liberal arts education, fell in love, and used it to change the world. Thank you.